Awesome. Hello, Thrivers. Welcome to Thriving Thursday. I'm here with Mark Johnston, our international marriage expert. I'm Heather Cho, international marriage and mindset expert. I know we have a lot of new people in the group, and a lot of you are very excited about our topic today, which you guys chose for restoring trust. And today, Mark is going to share with us three proven steps to restoring trust in a relationship. As I wrote out in the post earlier today, I feel like trust is like the blood of our marriage, right? It delivers the vital nutrients, oxygen, and support to the entire system. And without it, the other functions just don't function for long. If you have broken trust in marriage, it's like you don't have the blood in your body. You're just not going to be able to function, right? So it's so crucial that we restore trust and we do it in the right way. In the restoration equation that Mark and I teach. So, Mark, how are you doing today?
Doing well. How about yourself?
Doing fantastic. I did a live stream earlier. I was talking about how we had a little bit of a house fire last night. And so we've dealt with that, and everything smells like smoke now, but we're alive and we're well, and there wasn't too much damage. So, doing really good. And I related that to the, how if we don't have gratitude, it's like that fiery heart, right? It's just like burning hot, and we have to put out the embers and get to a place of healing. So if you haven't watched that, I really encourage you guys to go and watch that and do our gratitude challenge. I know it's helping a lot of people right now. So Mark, to start off, I'm going to go to some questions that we got in the group. And for everyone watching live, let us know where you're coming from. And if you have any specific questions, our comments, go ahead and leave those here for us. We can see them and we love to interact with you guys. So this question is from, I'm not sure how to pronounce her name. Sunilbi, Sunilba, I'm not quite sure.
I know I've spoken with her before in some of the monthly group calls. I've always pronounced it Sunali. I haven't been corrected, so.
There we go. All right. So her question is, how can you restore trust when one spouse doesn't accept responsibility for their actions? Is it even possible? So, Mark, we're going to go into our three proven steps to restoring trust as we answer her question. So, what is the very first step here that she needs to be taking and everyone else that's watching?
And I think this might have been something, that I should have communicated better to you, Heather. I don't know if these are necessarily like steps, like one, two, three. These are just like things that need to be around in order to in order for there to be trust. And I'm gonna explain these and then talk about how it applies to. And we're probably butchering her name, Sunalib's question here. But the Yeah, the first thing that I think needs to happen, the first thing that needs to be explained is basically what, the mechanics of trust. It's a lot of it's a lot of a give and take here in the situation where someone makes themselves vulnerable, someone puts themselves out there, opens up and is honest and spills out something, whether that's feelings or they come physically closer together or just discussing some very private sort of ideas. It's just some amount of vulnerability, and then that vulnerability being treated well. It's there's that acceptance and understanding. And so that brings us to that, I guess, the first, what I would call really a building block, a foundation of trust is acceptance and understanding. Because I want you to picture a situation here. Let's pretend that you're out on a first date. You can even remember back to your first date with your husband or wife, those of you who are listening. Let's say that even on a very basic level. So let's say your date there asks, okay, well, tell me a little bit about your family. And you go in and you're like, oh, it's a fairly neutral topic. We can talk about this. And you talk about your brothers and your sisters and your mom and your dad, and they just have this blank look and they're like, well, so what? I don't care. That would be really jarring. That would be really odd, right? And what would happen is if you kept meeting these sort of responses, the likelihood that you would continue to actually share things about yourself would just plummet. It would just, there would be no reason to do so whatsoever. Now contrast that with, you know, someone who is not only, you know, very interested in what you're saying, they're giving that encouragement. You know, there's those little signs that you know that the person actually cares about what you're saying. But they're, you know, let's say that you even share something kind of embarrassing and they're right there with you. And they accept that, they say, oh, you know, that's actually really cool. It's all these things together. I don't know. I suppose we can go into each individual one here. Is that what we're looking for?
Let's apply this exactly to what she was talking about here. So her spouse, her husband in this instance, doesn't accept responsibility for their actions.
Yes.
So how could we use some acceptance and understanding here in this specific case to restore trust?
Well, this is more, it's more complicated than just say trust. Because yes, there does need to be some trust built up, but it's not just in one direction. This is if you're trying to build up trust in one direction. Now, obviously, if you're going to build up trust, you have to actually deal with some of the problems. So let's take a problem. You know, I'm not sure what if I do recall, I think there was some sort of issues of trust in like talking with other women. If I can't remember exactly, but we'll even take that as an example. I'm not sure if that's Sunilip's husband's problem, but we'll take that. Let's pretend her husband is talking to another woman. And this is something that is not really, of course, it's not going to foster a whole lot of trust in this situation. If that problem keeps on going, and, you know, what are the issues here that are pulling away trust? I'm guessing number one is there's probably some deceitfulness, some lying going on about certain behaviors and action. Right there is already working against one of these building blocks, one of these foundations, that openness and vulnerability. If you then go further, you know, so there's some dishonesty there. I'm guessing on top of that, that dishonesty is met with some judgment and some blame and some criticism. So we're going against another principle of trust there, of that acceptance and understanding. And even further, you know, I'm guessing that as her husband, you know, does open up about some of these problems or struggles, that's probably not encouraging. In fact, I'm guessing there, once again, that judgment is coming out. And so there's discouragement for being open and honest. And I'm not saying that, okay, this is Sunilip's fault, because, you know, obviously her husband has some responsibility here. But if the strict goal, if all we're looking at is trust, then both partners in the situation are doing things that are tearing that down. Whether that is not being open, whether that is contributing judgment and blame to the situation, all of those things are going to tear apart trust.
That is so crucial to understand. I think I have.
I'm plugging my headphones. I don't know if that will help.
I hate hearing.
Yeah. No, I do.
Anyway, and hello everyone from Hawaii, UK, Canada, Australia. Good to see you all. Okay. So what Mark's just said here, I'm going to put myself in Sunilby's position here. And when your spouse is breaking your trust, you have an immense amount of hurt and anguish and pain. And that's all very real. What Mark's saying here, though, is that there's a place for that pain. And one thing that we encourage, actually we coach, we don't just encourage, we insist our clients do, is called effective emotional processing, so that then you can come to what your goal really is, right? If your goal is to make your spouse feel as much pain as you do, well then yes, bring that pain to the conversation. Do everything that would cause them to feel the kind of pain that you'd feel, right? Let them know how hurt you are, you know, tell them how awful this is and how bad it is and how wrong they are. You can bring all that, right? But what end goal is that going to accomplish? That's the natural human reaction tendency, is to add fuel to the fire, right? Or any other method of withdrawing, stonewalling, silencing, shutting out, in methods of, and it's all in an effort to protect yourself from more pain. But what we need to do is understand that if we want to stay in our pain, we have every right to do so, right? You have a right to do that. But what you're going to get, look at the end result of that. If you choose to stay stuck in pain and bring all of that anger, hostility, resentment into your interactions with your spouse, what is the end result going to be? Is that where you really want to go, right? So what Mark's saying here is if our strict goal is to have trust and restore trust, then you need to have a place to put the pain, okay? And I'm not saying you don't feel it. I'm not saying you don't deal with it. I'm saying you deal with it in effective emotional processing. And then you do these steps, like Mark's talking here, with acceptance and understanding if your end goal is trust. So I want you to be really careful about that, right? There's a lot of hurt. There's a lot of pain. You can choose to stay stuck there, and you have every right to do that, or you can choose to do what works. And to do what works, you're going to have to do what works. It's kind of one of those, you know, it's a simple thing, but to do what works, you have to do what works. And so this is part of that. So any other thoughts on that, Mark? Does this make sense?
Yeah, I want to clarify things a little bit. Like, I'm not saying that, okay, you need to, and I think, Heather, you were trying to get to this point as well. We're not saying that, okay, you need to ignore problems, right, or that you need to just be happy with anything that your husband or wife is doing. That's not at all.
Understand it. That's not what this is. It's not accepting their behavior. It's not saying, oh, I understand that you just totally, you know, ripped my heart out and decided to trample it all over the place. You know,
no. If we took something like this, I want to be a little bit more clear on this. So if we took an example like affair, like whether that's an emotional affair, physical affair, just anything that's, say, overstepping some boundaries here, the acceptance and understanding would come from trying to figure out, okay, where is this problem coming from, instead of just immediately jumping to, you're such a terrible person for doing this to me. Like, if, you know, if I was really trying to understand a person having an affair, I'd be wondering, okay, well, how are they hurting within their own marriage? What is it that they feel is missing? What, you know, because things like that just don't pop out of nowhere. The same thing, you know, we do the same thing with kids in ideal circumstances. You know, if we are taking a look at, say, bullies, absolutely their behavior is not effective. But if we're actually going to change that behavior, we have to understand, okay, why is this kid being aggressive? Why are they picking on other people? What are some of these underlying issues or needs that are not being met in the situation? And once again, this isn't to then pander to their needs and say, well, everything you're doing is just fine. I'm just saying, if you can come from a point of understanding and acceptance, if you can encourage them and really acknowledge their opening up, you're going to be in a much better position to work together than on that problem. That's that key. And rather than being in a situation where you're in this, we're in this confrontational or adversarial situation.
Yep. And that's what we see so often. Even right here is another comment, emotional affair, sad face. I understand that it's sad, right? But like what Mark's saying, get to the root of it. What is causing it to happen? And as your spouse opens up, that's the exact moment where you want to show acceptance and understanding and put aside the blame game, put aside the judgment, because that's only, what is that only going to do, guys? You should know this by now if you've been with us for a while. It's only going to push them further away. Our push versus pull. Exactly. So take a step back from your situation and think about what you ideally want to have happen, right? And what is going to get you to the result that you really want. All right, Mark, let's go to the next part here.
Hold on, before we even go a little bit further, I just want to point out one other thing, is that a lot of the principles that we teach are not meant to be taken in isolation. So, like, we don't just take this by itself, because absolutely, if there's problematic behavior, this is where we bring in some of the other principles we teach, like principles on boundaries and how to have effective boundaries that are going to feel healthy and are not going to be pushing your husband or wife away. But I just want to make that point. So you're saying something.
Okay. Yep. We're going on to the second part here, which is acknowledgement and encouragement. So Mark, how does this help us restore trust?
You know, I like going back to the analogy of, you know, budding romance and budding relationships, because I think it's such a perfect example of a situation where you are actually building up trust. And I can't remember how many times I've shared, you know, my stories of my own first dates with my wife. But see, in these moments right here, when you're getting to know each other, the likelihood, once again, of you continuing that is only going to be continuing that relationship is only increased because there's been some amount of feedback that, hey, the things that you're doing are pretty good. They're mutually enjoy their life. You know, I can remember, like, you know, my first date with my wife, there was even a specific moment that I can remember where, you know, we're watching a really terrible movie and I go to put my arm around her and she just kind of leans into me. And it was just this moment that just sticks out in my mind. Conversely, if I had done the same thing and then she just kind of shrugged my arm off, that would have been kind of the opposite of that. Like, no, don't do that. But here I was, and I was putting myself out, you know, as opening myself up a little bit with some vulnerability in a physical intimacy spectrum here. So I was opening myself up physically. And that little action right there was encouraged. And if we wanted to even go a little bit further, if we were to take that moment and do everything possible to build up that moment and build up trust, such that I felt more open to go further physically. She could have said, you know, she could have like told me how much she enjoyed that I put myself out there, that she enjoyed that I put my arm around her, or that she enjoyed that I asked her out on that date. And these little acknowledgments, these little signs that that bit of vulnerability is appreciated and encouraged is another factor that builds up trust.
Absolutely. So we had a question here. Oh, no, now I went away. Okay, he won't admit the emotional affair or discuss anything whatsoever. All right, so Mark, how could we show some acknowledgement and encouragement here when they're not opening up? They're not admitting an emotional affair and they won't discuss anything whatsoever.
Well, like I said, this isn't to be taken in isolation, these principles. And so there'd be other things to be done if there's simply no communication. But, you know, if I were to say what's going on right here is he does not feel comfortable talking about this subject. My guess here is there's been a lot of judgment. There's been a lot of hurt feelings talking about this subject. You know, those principles of acceptance and understanding, those principles of, you know, encouraging being open and it actually being rewarding, sharing some of what he has to think about this, have all been shut down.
Yep.
And we get that. It's understandable because this person is hurt. Mm-hmm. She sees, okay, my husband is talking to this other person. I'm hurt. So I should tell him about me being hurt. And hopefully then he'll understand me a little bit better and he'll stop. Ideally, that's what should happen, but it's just not, you know, most people aren't really kind of trained in these things. They don't really, no one has, you know, very few people go to like a marriage class before they get married. Oddly enough, my wife and I, we actually did go to a marriage class before getting married, but not very many people do. So the whole mechanic, what's going on here is he's not opening up because he's been taught not to open up.
Yep, self-preservation, absolutely.
So I would say in this circumstance, you know, I would go with a carrot and stick sort of method, as in I like using carrots first, as in, you know, cooperation, collaboration, rewards. So I would make it very clear. Look, I'm trying very hard to be understanding and accepting here. And no matter what you have to say about this, I want to take this with a measure of calm and acceptance. And I'm going to be trying to leave out some blame. And you try to push that concept for some time. If that doesn't work, then you'd have to start putting in some boundaries and rolling out some consequences. I talk to my clients all the time about this. Yeah, let's use a carrot for a while until it hits a plateau. And then if that's not getting any more progress, then we move on to some of the stick, which is not as, I don't think is as effective. But sometimes that can jar things up a little bit, shake things up.
Exactly. I'm just going to be vulnerable and share an example from my own marriage. So this reminds me of challenge that Ben and I had, where I had not been very open or understanding to, you know, the acceptance or understanding of his point of view on a certain subject. When we talk about getting our needs met in marriage, and it was my objective, which was for growth. And whenever I felt like we were having growth, he felt like I was shutting him down because I just wanted what I wanted to grow, and I wasn't really respecting or appreciating his view, right? And so it became a very challenging subject for us. We didn't, he didn't want to go there. He didn't want to open up about it. He didn't want to talk about it because he felt like he was just going to kind of have the door slammed on his face. And it was very frustrating to me because this is, here is my main emotional need, which Mark and I teach our 6 emotional needs. Go back to that training if you haven't seen that one. And so here I am feeling like my needs aren't being met, but he wasn't feeling like this was a safe conversation to have. Okay. So going through this whole process, guys, and be able to open those doors little by little by showing acceptance and understanding, recognizing that that's what had happened in the past, which led to this happening. Like that was the root issue for him, kind of creating that closed wall. And then opening that door slowly, and it takes time. It takes a lot of time. But every time he's willing to be a little bit vulnerable or open up about it, I immediately reward that with acknowledgement and encouragement, exactly what we're talking about right here. I say, I acknowledge that this is uncomfortable for you, but I really appreciate you being able to talk to me about it. It makes me feel safe and secure. It provides me a sense of excitement and passion about life. And so I really appreciate you doing that. And as we do this, the journey is that as we do it more and more and more, I accept and understand where he's coming from. And he strives to accept and understand where I'm coming from. And I acknowledge that every time he shows that openness, that willingness, then it encourages him that the next time he will be more open. So that's just an example from my own life, but it's made a profound difference for us as we've applied these things into our real relationship.
Well, if you look at what you're talking about there, it's this self-feeding loop in either direction, mm-hmm. whether that is being more closed off and being more angry, it's going to feed in on itself. And the same thing in the other direction, being more open and really being, really treating that openness well. It's going to loop in on itself and grow in either direction you're going.
Exactly. And I just want to point out, guys, that going back to the acceptance and understanding, if I brought all my hurts that, hey, you're not meeting my needs, you're not opening up about this, you know, and I feel like such a victim, if I bring all of that yuck and just kind of like emotionally vomit over him every time, I did that for a while. Do you guys think it worked? Right? That's exactly what we're talking about. So what result do you really want to have? I recognize that me bringing my hurts at his failure to meet my need in the way I thought he should only created more distance and only widened the gap further. And so I had to step back from the entire situation, process my own emotions, process my own feelings of hurt. And then as I brought understanding and acceptance to him and encouragement and appreciation, I recognized, oh, wow, I have actually hurt him as well in that same, you know, in this way. And that's what created the whole thing. So bottom line is we need to determine exactly what we want and then move toward that in an effective way and have a way to deal with our emotions so that that doesn't just become the huge obstacle blocking us from really having the restoring of our trust, right?
I do want to point out that mm-hmm. this actually is a good segue into our subscription material for next month. I actually haven't talked to Heather about this quite yet. So so we do have some monthly subscription material where I'm coming out with new trainings every month. This coming month is about helping your spouse understand you better. So how to share a lot of these feelings in a constructive way. Mm-hmm. This is something that I've been, you know, seeing a little bit more need of a focus on, at least with the clients that I'm working with personally. And so I wanted to put that in, just formalize my thoughts a little bit more into very specific training, some worksheets, some exercises. So if that's something that you really need, I would look into the subscription material for this month.
Awesome. All right. And now let's go to the third building block here. which is openness and vulnerability, which I touched on a little bit, but Mark, let's go a little bit deeper. What does this mean?
Okay, so you will absolutely never have trust unless someone is willing to be vulnerable. And so this is goes right into the heart of a lot of the principles that Heather and I teach of simply you going first. Yes, it probably will hurt a little bit at first. If you're the marriage environment that you're in, if it's not prepared to really meet a lot of that vulnerability with the acceptance, with the encouragement. But you can absolutely set the stage by being open and vulnerable yourself. I do recommend in a lot of these situations that you, at every step of the way, you make your intentions very clear. Like, look, I'm trying to be more open about this, and this is hard for me to be this open. So I would appreciate, you know, just a little bit of understanding as I try to do this. I'm trying to lower some of the tension here. I'm trying to fix some of the problems. But this right here is the key to actually building trust. Someone has to be willing to put themselves emotionally at risk. Otherwise, it just doesn't work.
Awesome. All right. So there you have it. If you have any questions about these three building blocks of trust, then let us know. It is simple, but it's not easy, right, Mark? No. It takes consistency, and it takes often the guidance of qualified people that know how to navigate these challenges. You know, we wouldn't have problems if we knew how to solve our problems. It's okay to have problems. It's not okay to stay stuck in them, unless that's what you want. But I don't think any of you are here for that, right? You're here because you want to change. You want to improve. You don't want to stay stuck where you are. So today, we're running a little bit short on time, but I did want to just end with a really powerful marriage visualization. We've got a lot of comments here. I really appreciate you guys stepping up and voicing your concerns. We will definitely reach out to those that we didn't have a chance to address live today. Because let's face it, the circumstances of your marriage are unique, and they need a specific guided and proven approach to be able to resolve them effectively. But beyond that, you know, it's the holidays, and I understand that when things aren't good in your relationship, it can make the holidays very, very challenging. It can make what's supposed to be really happy times even more painful. But I want us to future pace ourselves for a moment. I want us to detach from our current circumstances. I want us to think about where we ideally would like to go. And so I would encourage you to go through this visualization with me. If you're not in a place where you could do so, like, you know, kind of detach from everything, if you could do it in a quiet place, even better. But either way, you have mental capability and faculties to focus and use your mind, your incredible imagination, to really think about where you want to go. There is power in knowing where we want to go, in visualizing that outcome, in feeling the emotion of it. It tells our subconscious where we want to go. It pattern interrupts. If you're feeling a lot of pain or frustration right now, then you need to pattern interrupt so that you can get to a more centered and effective place. So we're going to go through this real quick here at the end. And if you need to come back to this later, then I encourage you to do that. I've also put it together as a PDF so that you can go through these questions on your own. And I encourage you to do that. But I'd like everyone to answer this question. If you can put it into the comments, then I know that you're really doing this, that you're really thinking about it. And as you put it into words, then that's quantifying it and making it very tangible. But where would you love your marriage to be 3 months from now? Okay, we're almost at the end of the year. And maybe your marriage hasn't really improved much this year. Maybe it's gotten a lot worse. Maybe it's gotten better, but you are wanting to get it even to the next level. So where would you really love your marriage to be 3 months from now? We're talking like March of this next year, right? Where would you really, or February, I guess would technically be 3 months from now. I'm already in January. So in like February, March, where would you really love your marriage to be? What would you love to experience with your spouse? And what does that look like? Like, what does that look like on a day-to-day basis? And more importantly, what does that feel like for you? What does it feel like? You know, say that you want to have trust in your spouse. You want to know that without a shadow of a doubt, they are committed to you. they are going to be with you forever. You are the only one for them. And that any other doubts or insecurities have just melted away, and you just have complete resounding trust in your partner. And you know that no matter what happens in your life, you know, come storms or hellfire or challenges, sickness, pain, financial difficulties, any of those things, that you will be together, right? You will be like a rock in the storm that can withstand anything, that you will be solid and unified, that you'll have passion and fun in your marriage, that you'll be able to, you know, sleep at night knowing that you are in a secure relationship, grateful and happy to have your spouse, your best friend in your life again. What does that look like? Here we got some. I want us both to be comfortable with him moving back home. Awesome. I'd love for him to, oh no, they're moving so fast. I lost it. I want to be sleeping under the same roof as my wife. You guys are awesome. I'm losing them because they're going so fast. And to have her completely cut off any communication with the guy she's met online, right? How good would that feel to you to know that she is with you 100%? There is no one else, and you can feel completely secure in that. Awesome. Yep, move both back in. Have us accepting of each other's feelings and give and receive love and to gain back the trust, exclamation mark. I love it. So what does that feel like when you come home to your partner? What do you feel? How do you want to feel when your partner comes home or you come home and you meet each other during the day? How do you want to feel? Do you want that tension, that tightness? No, of course not. Let's get to what we want. We want that feeling of openness, that feeling of excitement, that thrill in your heart to see them, the safety and knowing that you're there, that they're a safe base for you and that you are a safe base for them. What do you want the look on your spouse's face to be? Do you want to see that their eyes light up, that sparkle in their eyes, right? See the smile and the warmth of their embrace. What do you want that to be like when you guys rejoin at the end of the day or the beginning of the day? What do you want to feel when you lie down at night? So it's the end of the day. You've worked hard. You both worked hard. You've done different activities. At the end of the day, I want to feel, how do you want to feel? That peace, right? That contentment. Reviewing the happy moments of the day, the security of knowing that things are well with you. How do you want to feel when you lie down at the end of the day together? When you wake up in the morning, how do you want to feel? You want to feel excited, you know, eager to start the day together, happy to spend some time together, looking forward to creating more happy moments, grateful and appreciative for your partner. And then throughout the day, how do you want to feel? How do you want to think about your partner? What kind of text do you want to send back and forth? How do you want to interact? What do you want your communication to look like? Getting really detailed and specific so it becomes a very vivid picture and you know exactly where you want to go. And then some of the amazing things that you will do together. Like, what are some of the incredible things you would love to do with your partner now that you have complete trust in each other? You have complete security, love, passion, commitment one with another. What would be some of the things that you're doing? Maybe you guys have been holding yourself back from doing some incredible things together. What would some of those look like? So go ahead and put those in the comments. Really feel it. Allow yourself, your heart, to be open to that, to embody that vision and know that you can absolutely get there. Mark and I are here to make that vision a reality for you. So I encourage you to get this marriage visualization, take some time with it, really feel it, connect with it deeply. If you would like this visualization, all you have to do is type in me. We're just only going to give it to people on this live stream. Just type in the word me and we'll send it out to you. And I'd be happy to do that for you. Again, this can be your reality. It absolutely can. Mark and I, we see it happen every single day. Next week, we're going to bring on Leah Smith, who we've interviewed several months ago, but she specifically went through this, guys. Her husband was leaving her for another woman, was in an active affair, and had every intention of ending their marriage, leaving her and her son for this other woman. And working with Mark and I on these things, applying these exact principles of restoring trust, he left the other woman, and now they are working together and happier and more, you know, secure and happy than they have ever been. In her own words, she says, we're happier than we were even before the affair happened. We're happier than we've ever been in years. So we're going to bring her on next week live. And you guys had the opportunity to ask her questions, open door, and see what she did, how she did it. How did she get there? Because like you, she was like, you know, I would love to get there. I don't know how. I'm not even sure it's possible, but I'm willing to do what it takes. I'm willing to give it a try. I'm willing to get the help I need to get there. So we're going to bring her on next week. And as always, if you want our help with this, just like Leah did, then reach out to us and you can get on a free breakthrough call with us where we can talk about working with us one-on-one in our Express Marriage Coaching Program. We'll show you exactly how to restore your marriage in your unique situation. So if you're interested in that, then I will go ahead and leave a link, or you can say coaching, whatever you want to do, and we'll get that out to you as well. So, Mark, we deeply appreciate you. Any final thoughts? Any words of encouragement?
I think we've covered just about everything, but yeah. So, yes.
All right. Well, we're here to help you make that vision and that dream a reality. It is possible, and we can get you there. So we appreciate everyone for joining. You guys have a wonderful day, and we'll talk to you soon.
See you, everyone.